Why should you talk to your computer? This is the University of the Netherlands.
About 6 years ago, I started to teach programming to children. In the community center in Rotterdam, there was a group of kids and they needed a teacher of programming. And I was like, okay, I can do programming. So surely I can teach this to little children. But I didn't really know anything about teaching. But I didn't let that stop me. I was like, well, I can do programming, so it will be fine. They will learn. And then subconsciously, I started to remember how I learned programming when I was a kid to base my lessons on. And this was me when I was tiny Felina. I was about 10 years old, sitting behind the computer of my dad, trying out programming. And so I'm very old, so when I was learning to program when I was like 10, there was no internet, there was no YouTube. So what did I have? I had a book. A book that had games in it. It said games on the cover. So I was excited because also there was no Steam or other places where you could download games. So I was like, oh, this book has games. Let me open this book. This was what's in the book. That was computer code. I was like, oh, cool. I can just copy the computer code into my computer and then I have a game. It says so on the cover. So I will do that and then I will have a game. I was super excited. Then I copied all the lines into my computer and then I had a game. Yay, that was awesome. So this is how I learned programming, but note that in this story, there wasn't really a teacher present. No one was teaching me programming. And many people of my age, like the generation of the 80s, that knows programming, didn't really ever have a programming lesson. We as a field of programmers, we really lack a collective memory of what a programming lesson looks like. So when I started to teach those children, I didn't really have an idea of how a programming lesson should look like. I just also gave the books to kids and I was like, oh, they will probably figure it out. But it didn't really work very well. And it wasn't just me that was experiencing that programming in such an exploratory way doesn't really work well for children. Programming is a field in which many, many students drop out. Programming is very hard, and we are not really good at teaching programming. You might wonder, why aren't we very good at programming? Well, it has something to do with how programmers, but also other people that aren't programmers, see programming. If people think of programming, usually they think of something like this. Secret mystic codes that are within the computer. But actually, programming is very languagey. If you read real code, this is not real code. If you read real programming code, it has so many words. If you're printing someone's age, here's a tiny program that could print someone's age, it has all these programming words, if, print, else. And if you add your own words, if you add variables, those will also be word-like things. And then there's only a few programming characters in the program. So if you look at something like this, it's like, wow, there's some magic matrix-like stuff. But also, there's many words. It's very languagey. And we really know how to teach language to children. We know how to teach language. And programming is like language, like a natural language. Maybe we should look at how we teach language to children, and that way we could improve programming education. So how do we teach language to children? Most of you know a language, or probably you know a little bit about how to learn a language as well. If we learn a language, most people learn it by first learning all the letters. So they first learn the sound of an R, for example, R, and then the sound of an E, and then the sound of a D, and you can glue that together in a word. Chop all the letters and then glue them together and pronounce them as words. Sound plays a very important role there. You learn all the sounds of the letters and use them as an aid if you read words. But sound isn't just important if you're a child, if you're learning to read. Sound remains very, very important in comprehending words. And to show that to you, we will do an experiment. Because I'm a scientist, we need some experimentation. So what we're going to do in this experiment is you are all going to read a sentence in your brain in silence. So I will show a sentence on the screen like this. You read it in silence. And if you reach the end of the sentence, you raise your hand. Awesome. I'm going to raise the level of difficulty just a little bit. Instead of showing the entire sentence, I will show you half of the sentence. And then another half. And if you reach the end of the second half, then you raise your hands, like this. Perfect. Well done. This was a practice round, of course. Are you ready for the real deal? Okay, here we go. Okay, well done, well done. Here's another one. Yeah, so I didn't time you, but statistically, if you behave like normal people, then you should have read that second sentence slower than the first sentence. And those giggles were probably the effect of the weird thing that's in the sentence, because what you read initially was, I have a tear, like a teardrop in your eye. And then the second part appears, and then you're like, oh no, it's not in my pen. Why would there be a tear in my eye? Oh, it's a tear, like a rip. There's a rip in my pants. And then what you have to do is you have to go back, repronounce the word with the proper sound, and read the sentence again. They've confirmed these type of studies with eye trackers, in which you can clearly see that people go back, resound the word in their brain, and then read the sentence again. And this effect is not due to the change in meaning. And you might think, oh, but tear is a different thing from tear, so it has to do with the meaning changing. They've compared these type of sentences in which the meaning and the sound change to sentences in which only the meaning change. For example, the word calf. Calf in English can be your lower leg, but it can also be a tiny cow. So you can have a sentence like, my calf was hurt in the barn or in the gym. That also changes the meaning of calf, but it doesn't change the sound. And those sentences are quicker than these type of sentences in which the sound changes. So by that, we can confirm that sound really matters for comprehension. Even if you're an adult proficient reader of English, it's not just for learning. Sound remains very, very important if you read language. So what about the sound of code? If we say programming is like language, and in language, sound matters a lot. What would the effect of sound on reading source code be? So, random person from the audience. Here's some code. Could you read this code aloud for me?
X is 5. For I in range 4, print X minus I.
Cool. So you made some decisions there. So for example, the first sign, X is 5. And I noticed a little, like a little doubt there. Is it equals? Is it something else? So we actually did a similar study with novice programmers. We asked programmers, children, 12, 13-year-olds, how would you read this code? And they were also struggling. They were also making decisions on the fly. For a statement like this, a statement X equals sign 5, some children said X is 5, like the gentleman in the first row, but also people said X equals 5, because the is sign is an equal sign. Other children said X gets 5, or set X to 5, or assign 5 to X. Those are all correct answers in a sense. They all represent what is happening. But the fact that there isn't a consistent representation means that children might be spending energy, mental energy, on deciding what is that thing. And we suspect that that energy that they spend on deciphering the letters and the symbols isn't spent on actually understanding the source code. So we did an experiment, actually, with children, in which we had children repeat source code aloud with us in the classroom. So something like this, we said, repeat after me, X is 5. And the whole classroom would be like, X is 5. Very much like you would with the tables of multiplications as well. In mathematics, you would say 1 times 5 is 5, 2 times 5 is 10. You would practice that as a group, chant it together as a means of strengthening your memory. We also did this with more complex pieces of source code, like 4i in range, like we were just practicing as well, 4i in range, pointing out the pronunciation of all the letters and all the symbols in the right way. We ran a study in which half of the children read code aloud with us every week in class, and the other group was a control group where they didn't know code reading. It was just like a traditional programming course. And this first group that read code aloud did way better in remembering the syntax of Python. That's a programming language that we used. This is the paper, if you want to read it, in which we document that study. This is an interesting paper. It's one of my favorite papers I worked on, but also it's sort of So there's some pain in there because this paper has everyone angry and upset with me. First of all, people that are upset are the programmers. They're upset because programmers aren't used to saying source code aloud. It's something that feels a bit weird. If there are people that are programmers in the audience, they might agree with that, that we learn from whenever we start to learn to program that source code is for computers. You type it in so the computer understands you. It isn't meant, in a sense, to be a natural language. So it feels sort of iffy, and programmers aren't crazy about this paper. But you know who's also not crazy about this paper? Elementary school teachers. I go to conferences where I talk about these results to teachers of children. And they are not impressed. They're like, oh, so, Dr. Hermans, it is 2019. And you people in programming, you have figured out that if you make children read stuff aloud, they remember it better. Wow, we are so impressed. We didn't know this. We should try this with learning to read, the tables of multiplication, the German declinations. The possibilities are endless. They're like, we know this stuff. Why did you even run this study? Of course this works. We do this with everything. Why don't you just do this in programming? And that's interesting because there's some tension between we know this works in many contexts, but we also want to try it with programming and see where the boundaries add up. So it's really this interesting paper that everyone's like, why are you doing this for different reasons? So we know that it works. But we also want to understand a little bit why it works. Why does it work so well to sound out things that you have to remember? And in order to really understand that, we have to do another mandatory audience participation moment. But to make it a little bit exciting for you, I'm willing to bet some money. So what we're going to do is I'll show you a sentence on the screen very, very briefly. And if you can remember this sentence, I will give you 1,000 euros. It will be brief. Half a second. Are you ready to play? Okay, maybe this was a little bit hard. But it's not the length of the sentence that makes it hard. I'll show you another sentence of the same length that is really a lot easier. I am not willing to bet 1,000 euros anymore. I am willing to bet 100 euros for the next sentence. Same length, same time it will be on the screen. Are you ready? Still very hard. Okay, but I will promise you, your brains can do this. You can actually remember a sentence of that length for that duration on the screen. Let me show you another sentence. I am not betting anymore. You have missed your shot at winning some money here. But you can do it. Same length sentence, same duration. Here we go. So why wasn't that hard? Because rather than reading, oh, there's this one character and this other character and this thing like a plus, you can immediately make sounds of the entire thing, not just of a letter, as you could also do in the second example, but the words can immediately go into your brain as one thing, as one element, one chunk is what they call this. And your short-term memory is very, very limited. It can only hold between 2 and 6 elements. But 3 elements, like cat loves cake, easily fit in your memory. Even with cat loves cake, extra stuff fits there. You could think, oh, cats. Oh, I love cats. Oh, I miss my cat. If I'm home, I will pet my cat. You can think that while also remembering that the sentence is cat loves cake. There's lots of room in your brain, and that's because you rely on chunks and sounds. So that's why this study, probably, we didn't look into the children's brain, but probably it's the reason why it works so well for remembering syntax, because you can look at an element and immediately retrieve the right sound from your memory. If you would really want to win money, if you look at this sentence, what you would probably do is you would start to sound it out. You would do something like, oh, Oh, it's like an S, but reverse. You will give the character sounds. Something that's pretty, well, I wouldn't say intuitive because it's learned behavior, but it's something you can do very, very efficiently. And in studies they actually did with these type of sentences, this sentence, for example, they also confirmed that sounds are a very, very good memory aid. Because that last word, gebar, for example, people were very likely to remember it not as gebar, but as gepar. Because the B and the P have a similar sound, and because that mistake is way more likely to be made than, for example, gedar, that's a different type of sound. It is another evidence that a sound really helps you retrieve the right element from your memory. So it works very well for sentences, for language, because your brain is very trained to retrieve things based on sound. So if you're wondering, if you have to do something really, really hard, whether it's programming, or whether it's learning a language, or doing math, if you have to do something really hard, speaking it aloud works really well. So you have to talk to your computer, not for the sake of your computer, because the computer cannot hear you or cannot really do something with it, but you have to talk to your computer because it will help you remember stuff better. Thank you very much.